Testing, testing. Hi, good morning, everyone. Thank you for supporting the speaker series. Everyone, the series is made possible due to the generosity of donors to the SAS Foundation, and it's events like this. It enriches our community, brings us together, and we hope that you consider making a gift to the SAS Foundation. This morning, we are so thrilled to have Dr. Marcoux again. I know that some of you, many of you probably, have had the pleasure of attending her lectures over the years here at SAS. But for any newcomers, Dr. Marcoux, she is an American board certified developmental and behavioral pediatrician. She studied at MIT, University of Pennsylvania, Stanford University Hospital, as well as Harvard Medical School. For me, this is a bittersweet introduction, as Dr. Marcoux is actually one of the first speakers I actually saw when I moved to Singapore 4 years ago. I think it was on the adolescent brain. Still working on that one. And we're grateful that she, before she wraps up her time here in Singapore, that she has decided to share some of her wisdom that she's attained over her 24 years here in Asia. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Marcoux.
Thanks, everybody. Can you hear me? Oh, that's not good. Keep talking. I should keep talking and not stop. Okay, I can do that. All right, so good morning. This talk, any of you have heard me speak before, this talk is different. Not only will it be probably my last time speaking here at SAS, but it's also a much more personal talk because it's the result of my reflection of 24 years of not just being a developmental and behavioral pediatrician in Asia, but being a parent. I moved to Jakarta in 1993. I had a first grader and a second grader then, and they're much older than that now. And I learned a lot of lessons about being a parent, and I learned a lot about myself and about my community. And hopefully some of this will be of interest and or useful to you. So, lesson number one, 1993. If it's not right, being overseas does not make it right. Part one. So we had just arrived in Jakarta a few days earlier, and the air quality was poor, it was congested, we were stressed, and we decided to go out into the hillside near Jakarta where there was a small zoo and places to hike and that kind of thing. And so this is my then second grade son, and he's petting a live white tiger. Because for some reason, in the blur, which was our jet lag coupled with the idea that, ooh, we're on vacation in a tropical place, we decided that it was okay for our son to pet a white tiger. Mind you, the white tiger is on a chain, and you can't see it here, but when we walked away, the tiger did as well. The chain wasn't attached to anything. So we let, I'm pretty safety conscious, I'm a pediatrician by training, and I let my 7-year-old son pat the tiger. So I think one of the things about being overseas and thinking about parenting overseas is to figure out what your bottom line is on things like safety. And realize that just because you're in a different place, it doesn't change. So most of us actually come from places where children sit in car seats until a certain age. They don't sit in the front seat until a certain age. Various other things. They don't go to bars until a certain age. Safety is safety, and it really doesn't matter what the temperature is outside. Lesson number two, you can't always get what you want. When we started off our lives overseas, we were living in a part of Asia that wasn't well-resourced in terms of the amenities of daily living. When I first arrived, and I was a newly arrived expat trailing spouse, I and the other expat trailing spouses would get together in the morning, and the thing that we would talk about is where we had sourced food the day before. Did you find spaghetti somewhere? Did you find cream cheese? And then there was the person who didn't last very long, who was chronically looking for ho-hos and ding-dongs and Twinkies. She seemed unable to adjust her thinking. But the fact of the matter was, we were in a state of relative deprivation compared to the norms that we had experienced prior to moving overseas. And the joke was, well, how much was the American Express bill going to be for the first 48 hours after arriving back home? Because you would take that initial trip to Target, in our case, and then it would seem like everything that you saw was something that you needed. But in fact, a lot of it was just something that you wanted. Right, and so it was a meaningful lesson for our children after the first year that we did that we gave them a want-it budget and we gave them a need-it budget. And we promised them, I promise you, you will always have everything you need. And I also promise you, you will not have everything you want. And those two things were equally important. A few days ago, there was a TV show on BBC, and you can find the clip for it. It's a 30-minute show, and it talks about what happens to children when people don't say to them, you can't always get what you want. It's a show about kids who have parents, like most of us, who want their kids to have the normative amounts of technology and exposure to technology in their lives. But the research that this story reports talks about what happens to kids when they have that technology in their bedrooms and the impact on sleep, on children's attention patterns, and on their learning, etc. So even if you can get what you want, it's still the job of your parents to say no. And so I would urge you, if you have young children who haven't established a pattern of bringing technology into their bedroom, to not allow them to do so. And I would urge you, if you do have children who've established a pattern of bringing technology in their bedroom, to stopping it. Because virtually nothing good comes out of having an iPad or a phone by your bedside at 1:30 in the morning. Lesson three, 1995. 1995 was the year of the pig, and it was also the year that my third child was born here in Singapore. So it was a year for me because I'd already had two children, and I'll confess that my first two children were kind of, they came out of the book. They did what they were supposed to do when they were supposed to do it. They were reasonably easy to parent from a behavioral perspective. They caused me, as somebody who does the work that I do, very little distress in that I didn't have to think differently than I did every day about myself to parent them. And then I had my third child. And fortunately, when I had my third child, my mother-in-law was there with me. And after 3 days at home with my third child, my mother-in-law said to me two things. She said, never have your last child, okay? because her fifth child had been a bit of a barnstormer, I think. And then she said to me, when your daughter is 15 years old and she thinks that you're the worst person in the world, I'll tell her what you did for her in her first week of life. So, you know, the notion of children born under a given astrological sign as having certain characteristics is something that's quite prevalent in this community. And because my daughter was born here in Singapore, and she was born in the year of the pig, I was really lucky because I could get a private room, and there weren't that many people having babies when she was born. Whatever. So But the fact of the matter is that the intrinsic qualities that defined her and define all of our children from the get-go are things that we honestly cannot change. And on some level, if we try to change them, the message to our children becomes, the way you are is not good enough. So the classic understanding of what's called temperament is that we're all born with innate personality characteristics that define how we respond to the challenges in front of us. So I thought I was a pretty darn good parent with my first two, who were very adaptable, and who generally speaking were in positive mood, and most importantly, were, for the first one especially, very low in intensity. In other words, if he was upset, he wasn't that upset. These characteristics of temperament are evident in children in the first few weeks of life, and they persist oftentimes into adolescence and even into adulthood. You may not see those characteristics unless a person is stressed, but they're still there. My third child, by contrast, was highly non-adaptive, had a negative mood, had a low threshold, so that everything in the environment were things that she took notice of. Nothing got past her. So she was sort of the classic, what's called colicky baby, okay? And those elements of her temperament and her personality didn't change because she was born in the year of a pig. In 1996, the very, very kindly and open-minded principal of the middle school at Jakarta International School said to me, "Hey, Roby, you know a lot about kids. Do you want to teach middle school health?" And I was kind of looking for something to fill my not so much free time, but something that was new, challenging, interesting, and different. So I said yes. And I embarked on 6 years of part-time teaching 6th and 8th graders health. So you're all probably familiar with the general constructs of a health curriculum. I was a trained pediatrician. Presumably, I could convey to kids information about what was important about their development and their health. But I was doing so in an environment of kids who came from very, very diverse cultural groups. And so there were kids in the classroom whose parents had already had very deliberate and complete and comprehensive conversations with their kids about issues related to not just puberty, but also smoking, drugs, et cetera, et cetera. And there were other kids in the classroom whose parents had been a little bit more protective. There was one father who wrote a letter to me and said, in advance of the puberty unit, when we sent out the letter saying the children are going to start to learn about puberty now for the sixth graders, he said to me, "I would like my daughter in the all-girls section of the class," which of course didn't exist. Among the kids themselves, therefore, there was a really wide range of expectations in terms of what we were going to learn about. And I opened up the questions to the kids by just leaving question boxes. I was also teaching eighth grade health at the time. So I had one box for sixth graders and one box for eighth graders. And they could put a question in there, and assuming that it wasn't too inappropriate, I was going to answer every question that they left in there. And I knew that they would ask questions that way that they wouldn't ask if they had to do it in public. So, but my favorite question of all times was the question, "Do I have to do puberty?" And as I confessed to the kids in the class that day, I said, "Well, I don't really know what this question means. If you're asking me, is this a biological imperative? Yes. And if you're asking me, do you have to sit in the class for the next 6 weeks while we talk about these issues? The answer to that is yes, too." But the fact of the matter is that as a parent, your children's trajectory of development in terms of their interest in, their readiness for, and the appropriateness of some of the things to which they're exposed might be at odds either with your personal beliefs, your cultural beliefs, and most importantly, with your child's readiness. So in that same sixth grade class, there was a girl who I think actually might have read the Kama Sutra, because her questions fell into the category of completely inappropriate under any circumstance. And I didn't answer any of those questions. And I worried a little bit because I knew that in the spans of the 20 kids that were in the classroom, there were kids who honestly were deathly afraid of, and there were kids that were marching forward through. And all of it was normal. You know, that's the thing about these variations in developmental acquisition, is that the range of what's normal is incredibly broad and very, very little in terms of developmental delays of these kinds of things is actually abnormal. Prior to this talk, there was a group of seniors in here for their advisory groups. If you sat where I sat and you watched the seniors leave, you saw boys who were 6'2", you know, well-developed young men. And then I saw one boy who was about maybe 5'2". I mean, really, he looked like he could have been a seventh grader. And he's going off to college next year, too. So all of those things are probably within some sort of degree of parameters normal. And I think parents, especially in a multicultural environment like this, have to be very sensitive to the way that your children's perceptions and experiences might be different than what the normative experience of children is in the social groups that they're in. Lesson 5, 1997. This is actually a picture from maybe 1998 or 9, but no child chooses to be bad at their own development. This is the dance teacher. You might notice her looking askance at this one person right here. Maybe it wouldn't surprise you to know that this one person is my daughter. So from the time that my daughter was very little, she was tall. She was much taller than all the other little girls that she was playing with. And I think it took a really, really long time for the nerves to grow to the very tip of her toes so that she could know where her feet were without looking at them. So she was always the child during dance class who everybody else would be smiling, looking, da-da-da-da-da, what the teacher wanted them to do. And she would be, it was like there was a string tied from her eyes to her feet to figure out what was going on. And she had, because we were living in Indonesia, the children did a lot of Balinese dancing and local dancing and dancing. And then my friend Karen hosted this group of whatevers for a dancing class for about 2 years. And so the children did a lot of, not just performance, but just kind of expression, personal expression through dance. And from a very, very young age, teachers were always very, very cautious in explaining to me the perceived difficulties that my daughter had. And I was always in the mode of saying to them, well, if she could do different, she would do different. Because they would always say to me things like, Julia should look up. Julia shouldn't look at her feet. Julia should this. Julia should follow. And I would always say the same thing. If she could do different, she would do different. The assumption that developmental differences in children are within their control and that they're able to, because we think they should do differently, somehow develop the skill independently, is completely false. Things come along at the pace that they come along, largely within some sort of range of normal, and if we don't make a big deal out of it, then children get to where they get to. Julia doesn't dance professionally. I didn't expect her to. She's my daughter, after all, but the fact of the matter is that she still performed and she enjoyed, et cetera, et cetera. And luckily, her teachers were receptive to this idea for the most part. Lesson number 6, 1998. 1998 was the year that Suharto was overthrown in Indonesia, and we, like many expatriates, had to evacuate because we thought we were under threat. So with that taking place, we first decamped here to Singapore for a little while, and then most of us went back home, not knowing really whether or not we were going to be able to return to Indonesia or not. And during that period of time, we, like many other families, lived kind of haphazardly in various places because we really weren't sure what was going on. It was a challenging summer. And my daughter's father at that point was working for an oil company, and they were housing everybody in Texas for the summer. But I wanted us to have our usual routine, which was to go back to the shore on the east coast of the United States and see family there. So at one point, we had to leave Texas. And on the day that we left Texas, my daughter was at the point where she was pretty much toilet trained, but not completely. And so I decided to put her in a little dress that would come up and down easily, so she could run to the toilet easily in the airport and on the plane. My daughter also didn't want to leave Texas, because not only was her father in Texas, but a lot of her little friends at the swimming pool were in Texas, and she definitely did not want to leave Texas. And as I previously mentioned to you, my daughter was intense and could have a negative mood and could be slow to adapt her mind to the changes around her. And as a result, my daughter had a knockdown, drag-out temper tantrum at Dallas-Fort Worth Airport, starting with the curb, but she wasn't actually on the curb like that. She was wailing in her car seat, and so we had to take the car seat out of the car with her in the car seat and move the car seat to the curb. And then we had to take the car seat with her in it into the airport itself, into the lobby area. And fortunately, by that point, she had brothers who were 13 and 11, and they could do the heavy lifting. She was screaming, crying. It was possibly the most tremendous temper tantrum that I had ever seen a child have. And remember, I'm a pediatrician, so I see children have temper tantrums a lot. And it was my child having the temper tantrum. And I don't know how many of you have ever spent time in the Dallas-Fort Worth airport, but it happens that in the Dallas-Fort Worth airport, people take notice of and feel free to comment on the behavior of other people's children. So in the midst of my daughter having the worst temper tantrum of her life, I had a lot of people looking at me, making comments about what was going on with my daughter. And so we decided to just leave her there and to go up to the counter and check in, with her sitting there in the car seat screaming and yelling bloody murder. And so my two sons and I did that with our luggage, and the next thing I know, one of my sons says to me, "Hey mom, look." This was the son with the very low-key kind of style, and I turned around and I looked, and my daughter was still in the car seat, but now she was naked. At which point, my sons, because the lady at the counter had said, "You need to bring the car seat over," so at that point, my sons carried their sister in the car seat naked, screaming bloody murder. I carried her dress. Up to the counter where the lady, we put this car seat on the scale, and the lady behind the counter said, "Get out of the chair," to my daughter, which she got out of the chair in all fairness, but she still was crying bloody murder. And so then she walked through this was before the age of the kind of machines that we have right now, but she walked through the x-ray machine. She didn't have to take anything off, huh? She got to the other end, and then she just really dropped into a heap and just sobbed. She just sobbed. And she couldn't really talk about what she was feeling or thinking, and I didn't really think that really mattered at that point. So I just tried to console her and tell her I was really, really sorry that we had to leave Texas, but that maybe we could come back again soon. In those moments as a parent, which I think a lot of people have sometimes, when you feel out of control and you don't know what to do and you feel inspected by other people and judged, I think there's a few things that are helpful. The first thing is to really think about who the people are in that environment that you care about. So in that environment, the people I really cared about were my three children. I could have cared less what anybody else said or thought. I was never going to see them again, and even if I did, who cares? So my one son barely got his nose out of his book to tell me that she was naked. His younger brother, who's a bit more passionate, I would say, was like, "Oh my God, it's the end of the world. I can't believe that anybody has seen this." And then there was me. And so I applied what I thought to be the most appropriate strategy at the moment, which was the 5-year rule. And I said to myself, in 5 years, will this really matter? And the answer to the question, of course, was no, it doesn't really matter, because now it's X number of years later and I'm telling the story. What would really matter in 5 years would be if my older children had felt like in those moments of stress and challenge, I had let her down and I'd let them down. So there was a lot of reflective breathing, and there was a lot of imaging myself that night with a glass of wine. And we all got ourselves off to the airport, off to the airplane. The corollary of this, lesson 6B, is that behavior means many things. When children are angry, when children are upset, when children are frightened, when children are jealous, when children are doing any and all, when children are compliant, all of those kinds of behaviors represent a whole array of differences in terms of the way the child feels about the environment and in terms of the child's capacity to manage the expectations of the environment. So Ross Green is a psychologist. His most famous book is probably the book called The Explosive Child, which if you have a child who's anything like I just described my daughter, would probably be your Bible. This is his newest book, Raising Human Beings. He talks about the idea of what's called collaborative problem solving with your children. In other words, instead of adopting an approach where your assumption is that your child is doing what they're doing because they won't do what you want them to do, you adopt an approach instead where you assume that the child can't do what you want them to do. And changing your mindset so that you move out of won't and into can't, instead of being judgmental, and it honestly, instead of feeling like the child's doing it to you, you move into a more empathetic way of approaching your child, where you're assuming that the reason the child is doing this is because a struggle, the child is meeting with a struggle, and this is the way why they're responding in the way they are. And that you, in the way that you work with your child, try to remove the barriers to the child being able to be compliant or successful in some way. I strongly recommend, if you're interested in this kind of stuff, looking him up, looking at his website, reading some of his books. It's very important, I think. Lesson 7, 1999. In the aftermath, of the overturn of the Suharto regime, Indonesia experienced its first technically speaking, democratic elections. This was a green day. There were three parties, green, yellow, and red, and they had their rallies on successive days, and if you were clever, you had clothing that matched the color of the party of the day, and if you were curious, you wanted to see these rallies, and so your mother took you to see all the rallies. This wasn't democracy like I knew democracy. This wasn't democracy like I'd experienced in my childhood. I'm a child of Massachusetts and John Kennedy. So it wasn't what I knew, and it required a lot of conversations with our older children. This son was 11 and a half at the time, and his brother was 13 and a half. It required a lot of conversations with them about the ways in which different modes of government operated, about the evolution of culture, about the evolution of society, about not being judgmental, about trying to understand that you know, our democracy was 200 years older than this democracy, et cetera, et cetera. Just because it was different didn't mean it wasn't gonna be okay, was the theme. And adopting an approach where the ways in which you live overseas, you experience constantly expectations that things are going to be like what you are accustomed to, and you have to really revise your capacity. You have to revise your thinking so that your capacity to appreciate what's taking place in front of you is enlivened as a result. If you don't do that, if you're of the mindset that you have to eat Twinkies and democracy has to look the way your democracy looks, or whatever it is has to look the way your whatever it is looks, then you know, not only are you not doing yourself any favors because it's much harder to live, but you're not giving your children the expansiveness that they need in order to appreciate their experience. So this son, wrote his college admissions essays about Abdul Rahman Wahid, Gus Dorr, who was a blind cleric who was elected the first democratically elected president of Indonesia. You can be sure that nobody at the 10 schools that he applied to, read any other essays about Abdul Rahman Wahid. And what he learned about democracy and governance and the importance to people of authentic government as a result of that experience. And it wasn't about college admissions at all. It was really about the process of opening himself up to something that was very different. Lesson 8, 2000, trust your gut. This is a group of Jakarta International School middle school students taking one of those trips that their parents send them on that they never got to take. This group of kids include both my sons and included a lot of their friends, and they are in Nepal. You can't tell by looking at the group, but there's a predominance of boys, and what you really can't tell about the group was that there was a disproportionate number of boys in this group whose parents were teachers at the school. And those of us whose children were lucky enough to be selected, because it was a selection process, on the one hand, we always thought, gee, isn't that great? You know, our kids are getting this chance to do this and this chance to do that. This is the person who was taking the picture. Bill Vahey was an international school teacher for more than 20 years. His wife was the deputy head at JIS for 10 years, and he was a middle school teacher. And among the things that Bill did was he organized all of the middle school trips. And he selected for the trips a disproportionate number of teachers' kids, in part because of his proclivity for pedophilia, some of which he acted out while he was on these trips. And he selected the teachers' kids not because he was being collegial. He knew that they were easy marks. They were easy marks because their parents were dependent upon his wife for a job. It's hard for me to say because I work in systems and because I feel like systems are meant to protect children. And I feel like advocacy for children is my number one job as a pediatrician. But the fact of the matter is that no system is infallible. And parents who feel, who have a gut feeling of concern about their children are well advised to act on those gut feelings using whatever methodology seems appropriate for the circumstance that you're in. A couple of years ago, there was that movie Spotlight, right? And the movie Spotlight, I think, has changed. As a result of the movie Spotlight and the realities of certain circumstances that have come to light, I'm aware, for example, that in Australian boarding schools, the entire process of housing kids and grouping kids and providing pastoral support for kids and listening to kids has really undergone an evolution. So. But it feels particularly bad to me because I know that among this group of kids, there were at least three who were his victims. And so we can always look back and say we should have, we could have, we would have. But we can also approach situations with our minds wide open as to what's going on and to listen very, very carefully to the kids and the comments that they make. I'm sorry. Okay, something different. 2001. The lesson here is to be open to the teacher who brings difficult messages. So I'm not sure if you can read this. This is Michelangelo's parents' first parent-teacher conference. The kid's got talent, I'll give him that, but he has to learn to do his assignments on paper like everybody else. And on the right side here is the famous Mad Lib report card formula, which is, the child is doing pleasing work, I'm very da-da-da-da, whatever it is. In 2001, my daughter, previously mentioned, was a first grader. And she had been at Jakarta International School for the four-year-old program and the five-year-old program. And both of those years, she had teachers, quite frankly, who were afraid to talk to me about what the concerns were that they had. And honestly, it didn't do my daughter any favors. And you as a parent might have years when everything seems blissfully glorious because you've had concerns about your child, but maybe in that year the teacher has just kind of not really had those concerns. And there's a lot of reasons why that can take place. It can happen, honestly, because the teacher's teaching style is so well suited to the needs of your child that the teacher is able to meet the child where they are and move them along and there are no concerns. That's the best possible scenario. The less good possible scenario, however, is that you have a teacher who has a very, very, very high threshold. In other words, nothing bothers that teacher. And so the things that are taking place with your child seem fine to that teacher, legitimately, because the teacher's attitude towards kids in the classroom is relatively embracing. If you have a child, though, who has subtle differences in terms of their learning or their behavior, and then the following year, you have a teacher whose threshold is much, much, much lower, and then at the first parent-teacher conference, you hear about your child's handwriting and their behavior and their inattention to detail and their this and their that, it's hard to feel open to that kind of a message, I think, because you've just gone through that year where the teacher has had no appreciable concerns. I have to tell you that one of my happiest days as a parent was the Friday of the first week of my daughter's first grade year, when her teacher, who was very experienced and with whom I had a social relationship, because our husbands worked for the same company. On Friday, her teacher called me and she said to me, "Roby, we need to talk." And I said to her, "Nancy, I'm so glad you're calling me. I've been wanting somebody to talk to me about these things for the last 2 years. And I'm not that easy to talk to about my child. I don't know, I think I'm pretty open. But for the past 2 years, when I had been articulating concerns, teachers have said, no, everything's fine, everything's fine, everything's fine. And of course, what parent doesn't want to hear, everything's fine? But I do what I do, and I knew differently. So for me, that was possibly the best year of school my child was ever going to have, because I knew that throughout she was going to be honest with me, and we were going to be able to solve problems together. So if something is hard to hear, change the way you think about it. And try to think about it as this is a chance to really delve into things and to really critically observe things and to hopefully make change of a meaningful nature for my child. So, as if it isn't apparent already, life in Jakarta was like one catastrophe after another. We had CNN, we didn't have broadcast television, we had CNN, but we actually heard about the Bali bombing from the people on the east coast of the United States who heard about it before we did. And on October 12th, 2002 was the Bali bombing, and for our community it was meaningful because there'd been a team of adult rugby players who had gone to Bali for a competition and who had been, unfortunately, at the bar where the bombing took place. And so one of the truly beloved teachers at the school, Jamie Wellington, was killed. And this was a community that had already been rocked by other things, by a variety of other things. And I think in the aftermath of those events, what I really came to understand was several things that on a academic basis I had always known. The first one has to do with moral development. So these are the stages of moral development as defined by Kohlberg. I think moral development in individuals is something that is probably high on the list of things that most parents are concerned with. So it's important to understand what the norms are for different age groups of children in this regard. So young children, infants, are in the obedience punishment stage. And they think about things being right so long as they're not punished for them. Things are wrong if I'm punished, things are right if I'm not punished. Preschool children operate from a different degree of self-interest and they want rewards. So they're trying to secure rewards in their behavior. It's good if I get rewarded for it. School-age children have an idea of the good boy or good girl level of things. They want to secure approval, and they want to be in friendly rapport with most people around them. And so that dictates their moral behavior. And older school-age children have an understanding of fixed rules. Some children struggle because their understanding of fixed rules is so black and white that they really struggle with understanding that sometimes there is a gray zone. And this typically will come in at a little bit later age in the teen years, where people understand that moral codes and moral rules exist for mutual benefit, not just to benefit me, not just because I'm doing the right or wrong thing, but because it benefits everybody to function within a code of moral behavior that's appropriate. And quite frankly, a lot of people don't move beyond that level in terms of their moral development. They do what they do because it works within the context of the community that they're in. The next principle, level of principles that some people achieve in adulthood, though not everybody, is that there's a transcendent belief about what's right, and that even if you don't get caught, and even if the rules say otherwise, and even if everybody is doing it, it's still right or wrong based upon that transcendent belief. So in the aftermath of the Bali bombing, with all these high school age kids and young children who felt so at a loss to help, you know, what can we do? How can we do? Really, it was from the teacher community, I would say, that all of the energy arose for what was necessary in the aftermath of that, which was kind of, nobody can plan for these things. Nobody wants to plan for these things. So based upon the higher level of morality that people were able to adopt, there were no feelings of vengeance. Nobody had any feelings of harm to the dominant population of the community we were living in. So the Bali bombers were radicals who happened to be Islamic. The population of people around us were Islamic. And there was nothing related to that that came into play as this community tried to cope with this tremendous loss. Instead, what defined it was the universal principle of embracing the idea that we're all on this planet together and we all have to help one another. So it was spontaneous and it was creative, and children offered ideas and adults offered ideas, and everybody, each cultural group had different ways of coping with this, from religious ceremonies to traditions in terms of beliefs of blessings, et cetera, all of which were accepted in the context of this tragedy. And so what started off as potentially the worst of the worst, in some ways, defined the best of the best. Lesson 11. My older two kids were pretty good students. They had the usual array of, oops, I forgot, coupled with, oops, I didn't forget, I actually deliberately didn't do it. that most kids have, but for the most part, they fell within the dominant population of kids at their school who were devoted to doing well in school, interested in their learning, and appreciative of their teachers. One of my sons went on a IASIS trip where he was doing debating. In fact, he came here to Singapore for that trip. And when he returned to Jakarta, he had to make up the math that he had missed the previous 3 days, and there was a rule that the IASIS kids signed that had to do with how many days they could have to make up their work. And I saw him doing his work because he did his math work in the open, and so I saw him doing the homework. He actually asked for help with his homework from his father. I saw the work being done. I knew it was done. And so 4 days later, when he contacted me and he said, I've got a problem, can you help me? I was surprised to learn that the problem was that the math teacher had accused him of not handing in his math and was giving him a series of zeros, which at his school at that time, your homework counted. And he was a very good math student, and he was trying to get into the highest level of math for the last 2 years of school. And he had talked to the teacher, and he had said to the teacher, I did my homework, I brought my homework in, I put my homework on this pile, I don't know where the homework is. And then the teacher accused him of lying and saying, you couldn't have done that, because if you had done that, I would have had your homework. And so my son came to me. My son typically could self-advocate very well, but my son came to me and said, I don't really know what to do. I feel unfairly judged. What do you think I should do? And I asked him, do you want me to have a conversation with the teacher? And he said, I think maybe you should. So I went to the math teacher and I said, I said, my son's not, you know, an angel. My son's like everybody else. I'm sure that sometimes he doesn't do things. I said, but in this case, I saw him actually doing the math homework and he can describe for you where he put it. So I'm not really sure what happened to it, but I don't think that he should be accused of lying. And I think that if nothing else, he should be given a chance to hand it in again and not get zeros. And the teacher was kind of an absolutist. To that point, that was a teacher who didn't have children of his own, which I think makes it slightly a little bit of a difference. And he said, I'm sorry, a rule is a rule, nothing's going to change. He operated at that Kohlberg level above. and I said, okay, fine, and proceeded to presume that my son was just gonna have to do whatever he could do to make up for this series of three zeros. Later that day, my son called me, and my son told me, you won't believe it. Oh no, he came to find me, because I was working. He came to find me, and he said, you won't believe it. I said, what? He said, well, he found one out of the three homework assignments. He said, he did? He said, yeah, he had this other stack of stuff, and it was in there. And I said, and so what did he say about the other two pieces of homework? And he said, nope, he still thinks I lied and didn't do them. He had advocated for himself, most importantly. I had advocated for him. Alternatives were presented that seemed to be fair and weren't accepted. And even when the circumstances were called into question, no change was made. 2004, before you know it, you will miss it. Maturation happens. So watching those high school seniors traipse out this morning, I'm thinking about, well, what are their parents feeling at home? You know, how does it feel, especially if this is your oldest child, to be thinking that in a few months' time, your child is gonna be flying the coop. And along with that feeling is the feeling of utter panic because you know, maybe you're still waking your child up in the morning. Maybe you're still making their breakfast. Maybe you're still doing all their laundry or somebody else is. Maybe you're still rescuing them when they run out of money on their ATM card. Maybe you're this, maybe you're that, maybe you're this, maybe you're that. You know, I think that the idea of preparedness for the next phase of life takes it, the trajectory of development in the very end, in my experience, is very, very steep. Number one, kids start acting like they will later on with complete and utter disregard for your rules. And so therefore, you become a little bit more detached from them. And it becomes easier to think about them leaving because they're driving you nuts, quite frankly. But then along with that, they too get the picture that along the way, they're gonna have to assume responsibility for a lot of things that you've been doing. It may not happen by the time they go off to university. But I have the pleasure in my office of seeing kids come back and come and talk to me, typically at Christmas and sometimes at the end of the school year, for the first few years of school, because a lot of them are kids where I'm treating them for attention issues and we're still managing medicine. And we're talking a lot about the lifestyle issues of being in university. How do you use your time? Where do you go for studying? How much partying do you do? What are you doing to advance yourself in terms of thinking about your next steps, et cetera, et cetera? And I have to say that even in my population, and any of those of you who saw the talk on adolescent brain development, know that the frontal lobe of the brain doesn't fully mature oftentimes until 25, 26 years of age. And so, you know, you're always kind of iffy, and when is that going to happen? But this year in particular, I had a lot of kids in their second year of university coming back and saying, I decided not to join the fraternity. I'm really glad that I decided to live with who I live with. I'm taking a class at 8:30 in the morning and I'm getting up and going to it. So these kinds of things do kick into gear. Maturation does happen. 2005. These boys are at the awards ceremony taking place the night before their high school graduation. They're very nice boys, they all got nice awards. Afterwards, they came up to their mothers and they said to us, thank you so much for caring enough to say no. because we, one of these boys is mine, and the other two, whose friends were my, whose parents, mothers were my friends, had decided all through their high school career that we were going to very, 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 very gradually let out the tether on allowing them to explore young adult and older adolescent life. Not everybody does that, but not everybody does the other thing either, which is saying, okay, free rein, let me hold your fake ID, let me give you all the money you need to go out to the bar and have fun, either. 3 weeks before this, the boys were at this, the International SOS Medical Clinic in Kuta in Bali, where this boy held the head of a child while the nasogastric tube was put down. This boy held the arm while the IV was put in. And this boy called the mother of the boy, who blamed the boys for not protecting her 15-year-old son from the dangers of nightlife in Bali. Everybody doesn't let their kids do it at 15. And those of you who've heard me talk about this before, you know that I'm a hardliner on this particular issue. I don't think that young kids need to be drinking in bars. I also don't think young kids need to be drinking at home at age 15, 16. There's differences in the onset of addictive related behavior with alcohol for kids who postpone drinking until a later age. The development of the brain is impacted by even periodic blasts of alcohol in kids younger than that age. Lesson 14, timing is everything. Seize the moments to cultivate optimism. There's a lot of time spent in schools now looking at issues related to mindfulness and growth mindset, et cetera, et cetera. And I think that for a lot of things in children's lives and in adolescent lives, there's an optimal time for talking about these things. Kids have to be receptive to it. Over at another international school here in town, they've spent a lot of time talking with their sixth form students, the last 2 years in high school, about resiliency, mindfulness, et cetera. They had a dedicated program to it for an entire year. At the end of that year, they surveyed all the students and they said to them, what do you want to hear more about? What do you want to hear less about? Okay? The answers of the students, we want to hear less about resilience and mindfulness, and we want to hear more about study techniques. Kids may or may not be receptive to messages about mindfulness, relaxation, optimism, growth mindset, particularly adolescents who I think have a lot on their plate. Sometimes, however, you have very, very, very long car rides with your adolescent or young adult child in which it becomes clear to you that now we have this moment. Now we have the awareness, now we have the need, now we have the time, now we have the opportunity. So just because you haven't infused these things into your child's life until they're a freshman in university, it doesn't mean you're not going to have another opportunity to do that later on. Keep hammering home these themes with your children. I think in the modern world, it's the resilient, optimistic, flexible kids who are going to survive and do the best. Lesson 15, family meals and other sensible things about our cultures that we should not make optional. I think one of the saddest realities of modern life is not just the fact that meals are oftentimes just another place to play with your iPhone. It's that family meals rarely take place, it seems like, for so many families. And it's understandable on one level. There's practice, there's tutoring, there's this, there's that. My suggestion is that if you haven't already done so, you make a family calendar, and on the family calendar, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday nights, and maybe something on Sunday as well, you put in a slot which is family meal. And everything else works around that, not around the availability of the best math tutor or the best piano teacher. Because if it's not made a priority, the slippage is tremendous. And family meals are where you learn everything about your child. You know, that's where the difficult questions get asked. That's where the opportunity is for you to know what their conflicts are during the day and their joys and their everything else. There's a whole lot of other things, I think, also that we tend to sacrifice because we're overseas, we're away from our family, et cetera, et cetera. I think a lot of families, when they make this journey, decide at the very beginning to stay close to the nucleus of who they are as a family and to what's important to them. But I think it's a slippery slope. And I think that you have to be mindful of what's important to you right from the beginning. Lesson 16, a corollary to that, there are very few shoulds and even fewer musts. So Miriam decides to turn pro, and she'll tell you what you're doing wrong for $10. I think that in communities where people have access to and the affluence to be able to access a wide array of exciting opportunities for their children, just an enormous, unspeakable, really, array of things that could be done, the temptation would be to do this and overload. Earlier this year, I was having a conversation with a 16-year-old girl who goes to another international school, and we were talking about her various community service projects. And she gave me the entire list of why she did what she did, and I said to her, why are you doing all these things? You know, what are you doing with all of them? And she said, well, you know, on the college application, there's 10 lines, and if I don't fill in all 10 lines, it just doesn't look as good. If that has anything to do with why your children are doing what they're doing, take a big, big, big step back with them and say, nobody in college is fooled by what's on line 9 and 10. And it's really much, much more important that you sit together as a family, you talk about your values, you talk about modern, you know, current events, you rally together, you play games, you do silly things. Your child does things that are important to them. 2009, red flags in adolescence. This is a mnemonic, which adolescent medicine specialists and people like myself use to help us to make sure that when we're seeing an adolescent, that we're not missing any risk factors. It's really easy to remember. It's heads up and then craft. Heads up being a review of elements of the child's life, the adolescent's life, their home and their environment, how things are going educationally, their eating and their exercise, their activities, drugs and substance, I'll come back to that in a second, sexuality, suicide, depression, and safety. Some of this isn't so pertinent because most of our kids here don't drive, but regardless, I just want to focus on craft, which is the other mnemonic, which has to do with drug and substance use and the indicators of significance. Over the past year in Singapore, I don't know if any of you heard, but at some of the other international schools, there have been major, major incidents related to illegal drug use among high school students. Nobody is safe from it, nobody's protected from it, even here in Singapore. So legality is a big issue here in Singapore. Health is a big issue here in Singapore. Health is a big issue related to drug and alcohol use everywhere in the world. And the mnemonic that's useful is C for car, primarily being if you drive a car or you drive in the car with somebody who is intoxicated or high. So if you're an adolescent here and somebody's driving you and they are. If you use drugs and alcohol to relax. And I think this is a place where the model of parents alcohol use is really, really important. I think a lot of people, I mean, the information that we get is that a glass of red wine every night is like, you know, a lifesaver. It does virtually everything under the sun. But the message to your child that I use alcohol to relax, if that's an ongoing, constant message to your child, and that there's no other way that I can relax other than by having that glass of wine, then I think it's worth examining the model of your own model. Using drugs or alcohol alone, using drugs or alcohol to the point that you forget things, which at a more serious end of it is suggestive of a degree of dementia. Using drugs and alcohol to an extent that your family and friends are worried, that's a very broad category.
or to the extent that you've gotten in trouble. Any of those things suggests that this is not just benign experimentation by an adolescent. It's also worth thinking about these things as your kids go off to university and the environment that they're in, and thinking about the degree to which you, as the person holding the purse strings, wants to permit or not permit them to be in environments that are awash with drugs and alcohol, as opposed to school environments where the university takes these issues seriously. Lesson 18, 2010, what's different about third culture kid teens and who am I? This is a okay book written by some people who used to live actually here in Singapore, in which they talk to a group of expat teens about what their experiences are like. And I'm sorry because I don't think you can see this, but this is a graduate school parent-teacher conference in which the professor is saying, Barbara's very mature for a 28-year-old. She certainly isn't drinking as much as she used to. The reason I put that slide up and the reason this topic is important is because the research says, and if you read it all about the reality of third culture kids as they go on into their adolescent young adult life, that oftentimes during the period of time that they're living in their parents' home, they have kind of a delayed period of rebellion that's normal in adolescence. Some degree of pushback against your parents is normal. What the research suggests is that expat kids do less of that pushing back, third culture kids do less of that pushing back, that their buy-in, if you will, to the parental role model, values, et cetera, is higher than it would be for another group of kids. But the fact of the matter is that pushing back is a developmental imperative. In order to be who you are, you have to be able to contrast yourself and compare yourself and sometimes push back against who you are not. If that pushback takes place in a normal adolescent context, you know, you're 17 years old, your mother doesn't want you to go to XYZ, you sneak around, you go to XYZ. If you're 21 years old, though, and this happens to you, which it oftentimes does for third culture kids, it's delayed, what you push back against is yourself. I don't know who I am. I don't know what I want. I don't know where I belong. I don't know what's important to me. I'm confused. I have an American passport. I'm in school in America. I don't feel like an American. You're well advised to be mindful of the developmental trajectories of third culture kids and the ways in which they're different as they move into adolescence. And if you're in the market for a university for your child, to look very, very seriously at the percentage of international and third culture kids that the school has. Because I think that if the kids don't find people who can say to them, I know what you mean, then they're much, much, much more vulnerable. There are a lot of university programs, in fact, that specifically address the needs of third culture kids. My daughter goes to a university that every year has a symposium on the topic, for example. So you can find this information in a lot of different schools, and it's worth looking into. And then along with this is the idea that sometimes the place you're used to is not the place you belong. And, you know, depending upon where you are in your journey of being an expatriate or living outside your home culture or away from your home culture, the issue of where's home arises. And probably if any of you have high school seniors who've written essays and they've been able to write the question before they write the essay for the college application, a lot of kids write the question, where are you from? Because that's a deep, deep question for a lot of expatriate adolescents. And this word, which I had never really heard before, I think is a very profound thing, a homesickness for a home to which you cannot return, a home which maybe never was, the nostalgia, the yearning, the grief for the lost places of your past. So if you've been a serial expat and you've lived in a lot of different locations, there are a lot of other considerations in terms of development of friendships and who am I as a person as well. But regardless, this idea of where is home, I think is very important for adolescents. Lesson 19, 2011. We are only as happy as our least happy child. If you have more than one child, you might be in the situation where one or more of your children seems to be sailing, and yet you have one or more of your children who seems to be struggling. And I think that it can be very, very difficult as a parent to modulate your emotional responses to those two ends of the spectrum and to be able to genuinely enjoy and celebrate what's happening for your successful child while you genuinely worry about, commiserate with, or whatever else, and get help for your child who's really, really struggling. In 2011, the aforementioned daughter of mine decided to take it upon herself to really, really, really develop very, very serious mental health issues. She became she developed very severe social anxiety and depression. And so in spite of the fact that everything else was sailing along relatively well in people's lives and my family, it took a huge, huge amount of emotional effort on my part to provide the support that this girl needs. I have no regrets. I'm happy to say that it was all worth it, but it was a profound, profound experience as a parent to feel hopeless, to not feel like there was anybody who could give you a roadmap for the things that you needed to understand, to feel isolated and alone. So the corollary of this is that other parents matter. So this is the typical, you know, young child play group. Everybody's got 9 to 12 month olds who are cruising around and playing, et cetera, et cetera. And if you were ever a part of those groups, and I was when some of my children were little, naturally you're sitting there, you're watching your child, you're enjoying your child, and maybe out of the corner of your eye you're noticing, huh, that child has already got a nice pincer grasp, or huh, that child can already build with big Legos. Why can't my child do these things, right? Okay. That's the beginning of this whole comparative parenting element of things. Let's just be honest, that's part of what goes on, right? Okay, so when you're part of an expat community, and especially a smaller sized expat community, you have a lot of opportunities where parents are sitting around and they're kind of talking about what their kids are doing or not doing. And in this case, so those are canopic jars. Do you know what those are? So canopic jars are what were found in King Tut's tomb where they put his organs, okay? When your children are in seventh grade or sixth grade, they typically do a unit on ancient Egypt. And one of the things that's done at a lot of schools, and I think used to be done here, if not still, is they have like a tomb night, right? Where everybody builds things and everybody talks about the things that they built, et cetera, et cetera. So my two older children were back to back in years in school. And so 2 years in a row, and they were completely, completely incompetent and disinterested when it came to arts and crafts. So that meant that 2 years in a row, I, a little incrementally less disinterested and less capable, got to help my sons with their outstanding presentations for the King Tut's tomb, which in one case were canopic jars. Okay, so that sets the stage for what happens in parenting situations sometimes. So in this particular situation, the King Tut's tomb was the day after Halloween, and a bunch of us were sitting around at the Halloween event at school, and we were talking about our children's contributions to King Tut's tomb. And 6 out of 8 of us were commiserating. Ugh, I can't believe it. It's not done yet. He was supposed to start it 3 weeks ago, or she. You know, we haven't even done any of the paper mache yet. It's never gonna dry. I can't believe it. We don't have any of the stuff we need, blah, 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 blah. And then out of the corner of those cluster of parents, there's one parent who says, oh, do they have an assignment due? And then the parent says, I never know about any of her homework. She does everything on her own. Okay, so my friends and I winked at each other because we knew that she was what we referred to as a PPC, a parent of a perfect child. The corollary of that being that if she was the parent of a perfect child, guess what? She was a perfect parent. Those kind of people are toxic, quite frankly. They're not real. They live in some other world. Yes. They don't make you feel good about yourself as a person. They don't make you feel good about yourself as a parent. And quite frankly, oftentimes they're lying. So if in your life you know people who fall into that category, say to yourself when you're hearing them say, oh, I didn't know that they had any of those things to do. She does every, you know, give yourself a break. That's all. When your child is really, really struggling, that's when things, when other parents matter the most. And I think one of the things about being a parent away from your home country is that oftentimes that means you're also away from your sisters, and you're away from your cousins, and you're away from maybe your mother, even your mother-in-law in my case, the people to whom you can really let down your guard and say, I'm so worried, I'm so afraid, and you know that all they're gonna say to you is, how can I help? I'm here for you. What do you need? I'll do whatever you need. Having people around you when you're struggling and you don't know where to go and you don't know how to do, who can say to you, for example, I know just what you mean, is a lifeline that's just unbelievable. So finding other parents who experience the same things that you experience when your child is struggling is an invaluable experience. Some of you, I don't know if any of you would have attended, not this year, last year, Dr. John McKinnon came from Montana to talk about, how many of you attended, just out of curiosity? Okay, so Dr. McKinnon is a child adolescent psychiatrist who runs a school in Montana called Montana Academy, which is a place where kids who've struggled either with anxiety, depression, drug, alcohol issues, et cetera, go to kind of regroup and regrow. And my daughter went to that school. And as part of my experience as a parent in that school, I met a lot of other parents like myself who were going through what I was going through. And so as important as the experience was for my daughter and the therapy that she got was life-saving, it was equally important for me as a parent to have people around me who could say, I know what you mean. Especially because in my daughter's group of girls, the parents included somebody who was a professor of psychiatry at Harvard, a battleship commander, I mean, people who knew how to get their lives in order in all different ways, and yet we were all struggling with the same thing. Happily, if your child is struggling, if you put the time in, if you put the energy in, if you try to understand, if you listen to the hard messages that people try to give you, things do get better. So I mentioned that my daughter had social anxiety. Her social anxiety was so bad that she wouldn't leave her bedroom except to go to psychiatry and see her grandparents. And this is my daughter 2.5 years later in Petra in Jordan. Things get better. How to communicate with your growing kids, lesson 21 in 2013. There's a lot of different ways of doing this. I don't think there's any best way of doing this. And this is a place where those other parents who don't agree with you and make you feel bad about yourself, about the way you're doing it, you don't have to listen to them. The parent-child relationships are always different. Everybody wants different things. Everybody needs different things. There's no absolutes on this one. Understanding what's normal is very, very helpful. So this book is great. I'm not mad, I just hate you. And the corollary book, which is, I hate you, leave me alone, but first will you drive me to the mall? It's good to read books like that and realize that everybody's going through the same things you are. Healthy kids take healthy risks. So this says, see Jane walk downstairs, clap, mom and dad, clap. See mom and dad, clap, clap, clap for everything Jane does. Welcome to the age of overparenting. You know, it's worth it to take an honest look at the ways in which you affirm your child with an eye towards the way the world is really going to affirm your child, because you're trying to prepare them for what the world is going to offer them and the way that they're going to be seen in the world and the way that they're going to experience the reality of daily living. And I think the kids, pardon my language, but I think that their bullshit detectors are pretty finely tuned, and they know when you're not telling the truth anyway. So if you're somebody who's still celebrating the fact that your 12-year-old child got their homework done on time, I mean, really, let's be honest, who cares? It's time to get on with it. It's time to kind of talk about effort, to talk about who they are as contributing members to your family life, and to not just talk about minor achievements. Lesson 23, 2015. It's the job of the parent, not the school, to help their child be interested and interesting, and why boredom is important. So I meet a lot of kids from all over the world in my office, and a lot of them are super interesting kids who've had life experiences that I just couldn't even imagine. A lot of the kids that I work with have very, very, very profound genetic, developmental, et cetera, problems, and I feel very, very privileged to be able to work with them. But the saddest child I think I've ever seen in my office was a boy who came to me the summer of 2015, and he was a boy from an affluent family from another Asian country. And we were talking, and it was the end of the school year, and he came to me specifically because I had met his brother previously who had some developmental issues, and the brother had told me that this boy, the older brother, was beating up on him regularly. And I wanted to understand what was going on with the older brother, so I asked the mother if I could meet with him, and she said, yeah. So she brought him in because she was concerned as well. And what was truly and profoundly sad about this boy was when he told me what he was going to be doing for the summer vacation. So his parents were going to go to Africa on a safari, and then they were going to be going up to Egypt, and they were going to be going on the Nile cruise, and they were going to be then going to Petra. In other words, they were having an adventure-filled, interesting, stimulating summer. And I said to the boy, are you excited to be going with them? And he said, why would I want to go with them? Honestly, possibly of all the unbelievably horrible and sad things I've ever heard in my office, I think that was the saddest of all. I said to him, you're not gonna go? And he said, no. He said, if I go, I can't play my video games, I can't do my SAT prep, I can't this, I can't that. And I thought, wow, boat missed. Like, boat wasn't even at the dock for this boy to be the kind of stimulating, interested person that many aspects of his life would have predicted that he was going to be. The more you follow a rule book that tells you how to get ready to apply to college, the more you follow a rule book that tells you what you need to do or don't need to do for a variety of different things in life, I think the less genuine the experiences of the child become, and they become less interested because it's not really them. To be interested, it has to be genuine to them. I think boredom is very important. I'm the person, if you get on the elevator with me at Novena Medical Center, and there are children who are sitting there with their noses in their iPads, especially the kids where it's a double stroller, i.e. the children are typically under the age of 4, and they both have an iPad, I will say to the parents, I really feel sorry for your children, and the parents will look at me like I have 3 heads, and then I'll say to them, they're not having the fun experience with fighting with your sibling over something. And they look at me like I'm nuts. But the truth of the matter is that it's the mundane, everyday, non-packaged experiences of life that kids are missing out on because we're trying to keep things neat and tidy and easy. Finally, lesson 24. If it's not right, being overseas does not make it right, part 2. So the first part of this was the issue of safety. But the second of these is the issue of respect. So after the weekend in which I let my child touch a tiger, sorry, and I remember specifically the guide saying, it's okay, the tiger is drugged. Okay, enough of that. After that weekend, we returned to Jakarta, and on Monday we had the parent meeting where they talked about the buses for school. And evidently there had been problems the year before at the school with difficulty with kids and their behavior on the buses. And in particular, there had been problems because the children had been disregarding, to an extent that it wasn't safe, the requests of the bus chaperones to sit in their seat, to not do certain things, to not throw things. There were a variety of low-level behavioral things that were going on in the buses, and the chaperones were trying to control the kids, And there were problems with that. So the vice principal of the school was describing to the parents the concerns that they had about the way that kids were treating the bus chaperones, that the bus chaperones were asking them to behave, they were reminding them of the rules, they were talking about safety, and the kids were completely disregarding it. At that point, one of the mothers raised her hand, and this is what she said, and I will never forget it. She said, "How do you expect our children to respect the bus chaperones when they look just like the maids?" So I didn't know people very well at that point. I didn't know any of the people that I had moved to Asia with, but I turned to the woman next to me and I said, "If you ever hear me say anything like that, it's time for me to leave." You know, I think above and beyond safety, the next watchword for parents has to be respect. You don't survive in the world just by being of your passported country. You don't survive in the world just by being affluent. You don't survive in the world by a lot of other things. You survive in the world by being respectful. And so for me as a parent, almost 24 years later, that comment, I don't think I'll ever forget that woman. I'll never forget her haughtiness. All I can say is I could tell by her accent that she came from the state that I had moved from in the United States, which is a state where people are incredibly kind and cordial to one another. And she would never have said that of anybody from her home country. So, anyway. Final words from three of my favorites, in particularly the French. The perfect is the enemy of the good. Several years ago, somebody said to me, "Oh, you should write a book." And okay, so fine, I started to write this book. And the title of the book was Pass-Fail Parenting. And so somebody said to me, "Nobody will ever buy that book." But really, a lot of things that we do as parents that we allocate a lot of substantial energy to, if we took a step back from them and we tried to take at least some of them pass-fail, we would find that for the things that really, really matter, we have a lot more resourcefulness, a lot more energy, a lot more creativity, and a lot more hope. So thank you.
If anyone has.
Yep.
Is this working? This isn't a question per se. This is a note of thanks on behalf of all of us for speaking today. Thank you for number 20. I think that was what I was waiting for as the parent of young children. It gets better. I needed to hear you say that, and so thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Don't be shy. She's leaving.
So my older son is a very low-key guy. He slept through the night, his first night home from the hospital. Seriously, he slept 6 hours, his first night home from the hospital. So the notion that anything was ever really going to light a fire under him and get him to do anything that required moving fast had to be abandoned very early on. And he went back to school. He went to a college called Grinnell College in Iowa, which had an incredibly high percentage of international kids. It was a really diverse school. It was really interesting. He studied English. His first job out of college, he wrote horoscopes for a Wicca website. But his night job was really where he made his money because he was on a trivia team. So
One night, he went to a trivia team competition and he met a girl. And the girl had also majored in English at another typical, similar sort of liberal arts college. And she told my son that she was planning to go back to graduate school in information systems and library science. And she told him what that was all about. And he called me that night and he said, I think I know what I want to do. So he applied to graduate school. And in the meantime, he was living in Washington, D.C. And he had a connection to a job. And on the same day he got into graduate school, he got a job at the Library of Congress, where he currently works as an archivist. Nothing moves fast in the Library of Congress. Trivia knowledge is important at the Library of Congress. I mean, he basically was the person he was right from the start, and he became the person he is. He had a reasonably easy transition to moving back to the United States because he picked the right school for him. It was the right cluster of people. He and his wife are both third culture kids, interestingly enough. And now they are going to a therapist because they want to explore being a third culture couple. So it's kind of an interesting thing that they're doing right now. They feel, both of them, I think, feel like it affects their ability to connect with people who have no international experience. They both will articulate that. My second son, the one who was standing rah-rah green team, always knew he wanted to be a lawyer, after college, he worked for 2 years on the unsuccessful presidential campaign of Joe Biden. And then he worked as well, simultaneously, he was working for a state legislator in New Jersey who's now a congressman, Donnie Norcross. And subsequently, he went to law school and very mindfully decided what he wanted to do, and now he's an attorney in New York. And he's surrounded in his community in Brooklyn. He can go 2 minutes this way, 2 minutes that way, 2 minutes this way, 2 minutes that way. And it's kids from JIS, and it's kids from ISKL, who he met doing IASIS, this and that. His world around him is filled with kids who have international connections of his. And his wife did her PhD thesis in English on post-colonial sub-Saharan African authors. And they do a lot of reading by authors who are just tremendous and I know nothing about. So I look forward to learning a lot more from them. And my daughter, who really, honestly, she struggled a lot. She did. I don't want to make light of it. She struggled as much as any of my patients ever struggled. After finishing therapeutic school, she went to a boarding school in New Hampshire for 2 years, where she thrived, and she's now in her third year of university. And 2 weeks ago, she was in the Vagina Monologues, where she moaned on stage in Yiddish. So she was a very, very socially restricted girl, and she's kind of completely come out of her shell. But she, too, selected a college where there's an incredible expat welcoming group. She was walking across the campus the first day of school, and somebody yelled, Julia Marcoux, is that you? And it was somebody who'd been in her second grade class at JIS. And then she got into her dorm, she went upstairs to the third floor where her dorm room was, she walked around the corner, and she walked into a boy whose mother is still a teacher at JIS, who she had known for a long, long time. So those kind of opportunities to kind of reconnect and not feel so alone in the world have really made a big difference to her. For myself, I'm going back to Washington, D.C., where I feel like I'm needed, and I feel like there's a lot of opportunities for advocacy for children. So the reason that I want to go is because I want to be an advocate for children. And I'm lucky because I do work that's high demand everywhere in the world, and so it was easy for me to find the kind of work I wanted to do, and I love D.C., so there you go. Sorry, probably more than you needed to know. Yeah. Right. I think that
it depends a lot on the temperament of your child. I mean, I think that some children really do enjoy the minutiae of the experiences of traveling to different cultures. And because what we do is we're constantly like comparing and contrasting. We're seeing something, we're trying to see how it fits in with our life experiences and our knowledge base and stuff. And kids don't have that frame of reference, but they also might not have the capacity for inspection that we do. I think the reason to do it is because it brings you joy. I wouldn't do it because you think it's good for her. In other words, I think if you reframe it as I enjoy having my daughter there with me and therefore we're going to do it, as opposed to this is good for her and she needs to appreciate it, it takes a lot of the pressure off of it, and then maybe she will appreciate it more because you're just enjoying it. As for the whole idea though of kids who, because I think there is a subset of kids, and when I looked at colleges with my three kids, I knew that it was going to be painful for me with my first son, because I observe things for a living, and he's like a big picture kind of guy, right? And so I knew that if we got in the car after we visited College X and I said to him, how did you like it? He was going to say, it was fine, it was good, okay? And I knew I was going to want to throttle him. So in anticipation of that, we came up with an agreement, which was, there were four questions he was going to have to answer every single trip. And you might try that with your child as well. You might preview where you're going, looking at like something online, and then say, at the end of the trip, I want you to be able to tell me about the first king and the best food and the just four things, and kind of modulate your expectations, but prepare for it so you're not afterwards feeling disappointed again, which is, I think, the feeling that happens otherwise. I don't know. I think it surprises you sometimes what later on they kind of come up with about these kinds of things. I don't think that necessarily in the moment they're going to have those aha experience, but I think that later on you might find that it really meant more to them than you thought it did. Sometimes in a good way and sometimes in a not good way, but that's another story too. Yes. Yeah, most universities, if you go to school in the U.S. in particular, most universities have international student orientation. Even if your child is U.S. passported, they must go to the international student orientation so that they meet the kids who at least have who have some familiarity with their life experiences. And then the other thing is to educate your child very, very well about what it means to be a third culture kid, so that when events take place where they feel disconnected from people, instead of feeling like it's me, it's only me, they can then say to themselves, oh, this is that third culture kid thing I'd read about and I knew to expect. And so it's not me personally. Being able to kind of come up with a way of describing the experiences you're having, which you don't personalize as much, and which is explainable based upon other phenomena, I think is really, really helpful for kids. And you know, the other thing that I would say about those kinds of experiences is that I think in a university setting, especially if you're far, far, far away from home, I think mentorship is really important. So if in any way, shape, or form possible, the first semester of their freshman year, they should take the smallest class that's available for a freshman. In other words, if it's a seminar or if it's whatever it is, one class that's much, if you're in a school with big, big classes, try to find one learning opportunity for your child, which is a very small class, so that immediately there's a sense of connectedness to an adult at the university that you wouldn't have if you're just sitting in a class of 400 kids all the time. Yeah. Right. Right. I think number one, what the research says is that if kids fight,
and you look at them in like later life, it's not the fact, it's not whether or not they fought together that matters, it's whether or not they laughed together. So long as they also laugh, then it's okay. I think that sometimes, especially in Asian cultures, older children are assigned responsibility for younger siblings, and they feel responsible. You know, Coco has to look after a younger sister, whatever, Mei Mei and everything else. And I think that that establishes a hierarchy that then becomes sometimes codified. In other words, that the older sibling feels ultimately responsible for everything that the younger sibling does. And when the younger sibling doesn't conform or doesn't do it as well, the older sibling is upset because they think it's a reflection on them. Does that make sense? It's not the relationship between them that's the issue. It's the way the older sibling interprets what is thought of them because of the younger child's behavior. So the conversation I think that has to take place is with the older sibling and liberating them from the feeling that they have responsibility for these. You know, if you're in a busy setting, yeah, you're responsible for the safety of your younger sibling. You're responsible for being a good role model because you're the older sibling. But above and beyond that, the inconsistencies in your younger sibling's behavior are not your responsibility. You're not in charge of them. You can't control them. You can't change them, you know. With that, I think that older siblings sometimes feel liberated, and then they can kind of enjoy the silliness, et cetera, of their younger sibling, rather than feeling like they have to change it all the time. I think this happens in my office all the time, that the older kids feel burdened by this and responsible for the behavior of younger kids, and especially in my office, where a lot of the younger kids, their behavior can be very, very difficult for even experienced adults to manage. It shouldn't be left to the expectation that the older sibling is going to manage it. Well, I think a lot of times parents create that. They glorify the older sibling. So I think the first thing to do is to examine the way in which you're talking about what the older sibling is doing. And then I think it's important that the younger one understand what was their older sibling doing when they were your age. You know, looking up to them is one thing, but this sibling was 6 years old once before, and guess what? You know, he was afraid at his piano recital, and he ran off stage, and he got up in class, and he forgot what he was going to say, and he did really, really well in math, but he couldn't read very well. I mean, bring it back down to the level of where the child is, rather than making the child focused on the way their older sibling is now. I think you can talk about being respectful of the differences in the way people believe and act and the choices that they make while simultaneously making it very clear to your child that in your family, this is the way we believe, that we act, that we this and that we that. I think that if you feel that your child is in any degree of danger because of discrepancies between supervision and supervision between homes, for example, I think you are well within your boundaries as the parent to say to your child, your friend is always welcome here. You cannot go to anybody else's house unless I know that there is a parent there. I would establish that as a ground rule, and I wouldn't not enforce that all the way through high school, quite frankly. It's within your prerogative as a parent, if that's the code that you have for your family, to enforce that, even when around you, you see that other people are making other choices. And it's part of being in a multicultural environment that kids learn that in this family, they do things this way, and in our family, we do things this way, and in that family, they do things this way. And, you know, we're respectful of everybody, but we know how we function within our family. There was a slide of a meal where Kevin was talking about his friends,
habits, and I didn't mention then, but one day my son Kevin, brought a child home who came from a culture where people use forks and knives. Not everybody did, but this particular child, and I was always mindful of who was coming home for meals, thinking about what were we gonna serve, depending upon what I knew the cultural expectations would be of the kids that were coming. But in this case, the child came from a culture that used forks and knives, but had never been taught how to do so. And so he stabbed the piece of meat like this, and then he, like that. And afterwards, it was an opportunity for us to have a conversation about that, you know? Number one, it was a reminder of my children of why I wanted them to demonstrate appropriate table manners. But it was also a chance for us to talk about, did his parents do him any favors by not having expectations for him? That was an interesting conversation. And the kids came down on the idea that no, you know, the norm of the community would be that you would be able to do those things. And so you're embarrassed because you can't do those things. Your parents didn't do you any favors. It was an interesting conversation. Yes.
And how did you reconcile sending your reconcile sending your daughter off to share the school?
It can happen anywhere. I think the onus is on people who supervise kids and adolescents to be able to describe a cohesive plan of protecting kids and of supervision of kids. Now that heightened awareness worldwide over these kinds of things, if you do not hear that there is a specific plan in place, then I would walk away. I think that most schools nowadays are, as I said, I send a lot of my patients seem to go to boarding school in Australia, among other places, and a lot of the parents have showed me the pages in the books, in the everything that are coming home now. Like at some of the schools, they have cameras in bedrooms, and they've changed the bathrooms for kids at a lot of schools so that instead of it being big, huge bathrooms, it's, you know, the schools have responded to these things. So if you're looking at a school and they're saying, oh, we've never had problems like that, do not believe it, and assume that they're putting their heads in the sand, and look for places where they're really taking this seriously. So for myself, in sending my daughter off to situations, because of the nature of what was taking place in these circumstances, in the beginning, she was never more than 100 meters away from two adults at a time. So there was always a check and balance, but I was mindful of these things all the time. It's a good question. Right.
Like, you can't be shy. Because your kids are that reason my body hurts when you don't
protect
them.
Right.
And you don't protect them.
Right. I think that there's a curriculum in the schools, in this school, that talks about, you know, my safe personal safety, et cetera, et cetera. In some of the cultural environments around Asia, attitudes towards touching, for example, are different. I mean, they're just different cultural beliefs about it. And I think that children from a very young age can understand that there are differences, but also be told very clearly, if it doesn't feel comfortable to you, I want to hear about it right away. And creating safe zones for that, for the children. And if they say it, believe it. I mean, the idea of they have to prove this to you just defies what's understood about children in these circumstances, where they feel like they've done the wrong thing and they're embarrassed. And so if they come forth and they say something about it, they need to feel heard and they need to feel validated. And it is a challenge in a multicultural environment because there will be different norms of things like touching behaviors. So it's really important here that kids understand if it feels uncomfortable, it feels uncomfortable. My daughter, when she was little, had massive curly hair, and massive. And every place we went, everybody always wanted to touch her hair. And so we used to call her the little ambassador, because we would be like on a train in China or at the Buddha in Thailand, and somebody would come up, and without asking, because she was a child and people didn't feel like they needed to ask, they would start to touch her hair. And from the time she could talk, she would push away their hand and she would say, "My hair, my body." and we endorsed it. And it, again, this is a matter of like, well, you don't want to be rude, but on the other hand, who do you really care about? Well, I really cared about empowering my daughter to be able to say no. Different schools handle it differently, but it's important that, number one, that issues related to like dormitory safety, privacy, are doors open, are they locked, who has access, who doesn't have access, who's in the dorm, not on Monday through Friday, but who's in the dorm on Saturdays and Sundays. Those are really important questions. In terms of access. Other important concerns are exactly as was true for the situation with Mr. Vahey. What kinds of logistical protections are there in place during school trips? In other words, gender, what are the genders of the faculty on the trip? If there's female and male students, there should be female and male faculty, period, end of discussion. How are kids allocated to spaces, et cetera, et cetera. I have a feeling Regina's gonna tell me time's up. I don't know that there's kind of a succinct guide for this. I think the Yale has a big child protection service program through their Department of Pediatrics. You might go to their website, and I think that they have guidelines there specifically. Last question? I think kids are going to desperate measures to meet expectations that are unrealistic. Last year I did an audit of the support services program at another international school here in Singapore, and we were looking at whether or not their support services programming was indeed supporting the students that they had all throughout the school in terms of their well-being educationally and emotionally. And as part of the discussion, we interviewed the principal of the high school. And in that interview, I said to the principal, you're an IB school. The IB demands are already very high in terms of coursework, community service, extended essay, I said, but it seems to me like a lot of your students are doing even more, even in excess of what that very stringent curricular program expects of them. And I said, do you have any thoughts about that? And he said to me, well, how are we going to stop them? Our kids are so special. They all want to do more and more and more and more and more. So what ends up happening in these kinds of discussions is that, honestly, schools say it's not our problem. Parents say it's not our problem. So that only means that the kids want to be this stressed, which to me doesn't make sense. So I said to the principal, I said, you know what I said? I said, actually, I think it's the job of adults who care about adolescents to sometimes say to them, you are doing too much and I am not going to let you. That's what you do. You use good common sense and you say, if my child is having to stay up every night till 1 a.m. and they're only sleeping 5 hours and they're getting sick all the time and their teeth are ratty and their hair is ratty and they've got a stomach ache and they're stressed and they're this and they're that, it's your job as the parent to say, enough. When my older two were at GIST is a school that has a full IB curriculum and then has a full American and AP curriculum. And the idea was that the IB curriculum was the most competitive curriculum, and that if your child was a good student, they had to do the most competitive curriculum or the colleges that they were applying to would look down on their scores, et cetera, et cetera. So 2 years in a row, I went to exactly the same counselor, because, you know, signed by letter of the alphabet, and the counselor said, when my son said what he wanted to take in his junior and senior year of high school, the counselor said, but you're not taking the most competitive curriculum, because they wanted to take advanced placement English instead of IB English, and they wanted to take this math class instead of that math class, primarily because they loved the teachers who were teaching that class. They knew the teachers, they'd had them in the lower grades, and they wanted those teachers. And the counselor reiterated, and I said to the counselor, in our family, we do not do anything because we are afraid. That's what I said to the counselor. I said, I am not afraid that my child is not going to get into a good college because he's not doing full IB. Yeah. Really? And my second son was mildly dyslexic, and he couldn't spell in English, and he certainly could not spell in French. And the French teacher, who loved my son, said to my son, you can't do, and he wanted to do the highest level of French. And the French teacher said to him, but you're never going to get anything higher than a B minus because you can't spell. And my son said to the French teacher, he says, I don't care if I ever can spell in French or not. There's this really cute girl at the French school. Sure enough, he never got anything higher than a B minus in French. He also didn't make National Honor Society. Guess what? He went to an Ivy League school and to a top 14 law school and did just fine, thank you very much. Never do anything because you're afraid. That was the watchword. If your child's only doing it to try to keep up and because they're afraid somebody else is getting ahead of them, forget it. Do what's genuine to you. You know, it just, I think there's so many levels of this, I don't even know where to start. But I will say that somewhere along the way, people have gotten the idea that being over-programmed as an 18-year-old is a good thing for you, and I think it's a terrible thing for you. I think at 18, you should be doing things that are complicated and hard and confusing and making mistakes, and realize you're gonna be able to survive in this world in spite of those mistakes. I think that's what you need to learn to do when you're 18. You know, not feel like there's a prescribed path for doing things, and if you don't do things exactly the way everybody else is doing it, you're gonna lose out on opportunities in life. I just don't buy it. So say no. Yep.
Great.
Yep, there you go.
Well,
thanks.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone, for coming. We're really going to miss you, Roby. You've been so invaluable to the SS community. And I really hope this doesn't mean this is just a see you later, you'll come back and visit Singapore, because age is such a big part of your professional experience. And we've all benefited so much from your wisdom. So. Join me again in thanking Dr. Roby.
Thank you, Jane.
And everyone, please enjoy any refreshments we have outside. Thank you.